body, there's no reason to think he wouldn't be left-handed in his new body. Perhaps it was the habit of the way he did it. Instead of breaking it in half, perhaps he tore off the ends first. But something about Jesus was recognizable. Well, that leads to the question, what will our bodies be like in heaven? Remember, John said, we shall be like him. Colossians 1:18 says that Jesus was the firstborn from the dead. That word firstborn is the Greek word prototokos. Prototokos. He is the prototype of those who are to be raised from the dead. You know, if Toyota or General Motors is going to build a new automobile, before they ever fire up the assembly line, the first thing they do is they build a prototype of that automobile to make sure it's what they want it to be, to make sure it works. And only after the prototype is built, then every other car comes down that assembly line that perfectly matches the prototype. And that's what our resurrection is going to be like. It is going to be modeled after the prototype, the firstborn, Jesus Christ himself. He is the prototokos, the prototype of those, all of us, who will be raised from the dead. So knowing that that is true, we can gather several important facts about our new bodies in heaven. First of all, our bodies will be physical. Just as Jesus had a physical body, so will we. Now, our new bodies will be vastly different than our original bodies. Make no mistake about it. In verses 39 to 41 of 1 Corinthians 15, Paul said, all flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one flesh of men and another flesh of beasts and another flesh of birds and another flesh of fish. Verse 40, there are also heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is one and the glory of the earthly is another. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, another glory of the stars, for stars differ from star in their glory. What's the point of all of that? Paul is saying, don't find it hard to believe that our new bodies would be different than our earthly bodies. God designs our bodies just like he does animals and fish and the stars and the moon, all to serve their unique purpose. Verses 42 to 44. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown a perishable body, it is raised an imperishable body. It is sown in dishonor, but it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. But notice the word body, soma in Greek, is repeated over and over again. That refers to a physical body. It's Paul's way of saying, don't miss this. We are a body, but on earth, in our current state, we are a natural body, but in the new heaven and new earth, we will be spiritual, but we will still be a body. Let me summarize for you, if I can, the differences between our earthly body and our heavenly body for the new heaven and new earth. Jot these down on your outline. First of all, our earthly bodies decay. Our heavenly bodies will endure. Secondly, our earthly bodies are infected with sin. Our heavenly bodies will be free of sin. Thirdly, our earthly bodies are weak. Our heavenly bodies will be powerful. And finally, our earthly bodies are for the old earth. Our heavenly bodies are for the new earth. Now, people have all kinds of questions about what we'll be able to do in our new bodies and what they will be like. The best way to answer those questions is to look at the body of Jesus. For example, we discover, number one, we will eat in our new bodies. Can I hear an amen on that? Should we get closer to lunchtime? Yes. We will eat in our new bodies. Remember when Jesus appeared before his disciples? You know, they were just so awestruck at seeing the risen Lord. You know, they wanted to pray and have a Bible study. Jesus said, hey, can somebody get me something to eat? I'm hungry. Give me something to eat. We'll be hungry in heaven and we'll have plenty to eat. Luke 22, verses 29 and 30, Jesus said, just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, I grant you that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. Secondly, we will wear clothes in heaven. We will actually have clothes in heaven. How do I know that? Well, the Bible describes Jesus as being clothed. Revelation 1:13, in his resurrection body, he was clothed in a robe reaching to his feet, and girding across his chest was a golden sash. For Revelation 3:5 promises, he who overcomes will thus be clothed in white garments. In Revelation 19, the second coming of Christ, we the church are pictured as coming with Christ, and we the church will be dressed in fine linens, bright and clean. Thirdly, we will retain our sexual identities in heaven. There's no transgender in heaven. We will be male and female just as God created us. You say, how do you know that? Especially when you consider verses like Galatians 3:28 that says, in Christ there is neither male nor female. Some people point to that verse and say, well, there'll be no more gender in heaven. No, that verse is talking about right now, about our equality before God. In God's eyes right now, God makes no distinction in status before him between male and female. If you are in Christ, you are equal before your Heavenly Father. He's not talking about the future. In the future, we will retain the genders by which God created us. How do I know that? I could point to a lot of evidence, but in Luke 24, verse 16, Jesus is with his disciples on the road to Emmaus. They didn't first recognize him. Look at Luke 24, verse 16. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. You say, well, how does that relate to gender? Well, obviously, when they were talking to Jesus, he appeared to be somebody else. He appeared to be just another man. He didn't appear as some otherworldly, sexless alien. They would have had a whole different conversation if that had been the case. But he looked like another man, another human being. And so it will be in our resurrection bodies. We will retain our gender. Some people want to know, well, what age will we be in heaven? That's mere speculation. Some people say we'll be like Jesus, who was 30 years old when he began his ministry. The Old Testament priests began their service in the temple at age 30. Perhaps age 30 will be our age. Actually, we don't know, but we will be the best version of ourselves we can imagine. Secondly, our bodies will not only be physical, they will also be perfect. They will be perfect. No more cancer, no more heart attacks, no more strokes, no more high blood pressure. Revelation 21 verse 4 says, the first things will have passed away. Revelation 22 verse 3, and there shall no longer be any curse. Many of you know Johnny Erickson, my friend, a great woman of God. At age 17, through a diving accident, became a quadriplegic. Listen to what Johnny has to say about the promise of a new body. Can you imagine the hope this gives someone like me with a spinal cord injury? Or someone who is cerebral palsied, brain injured, or has multiple sclerosis? Imagine the hope this gives someone who is a manic depressive. No other religion, no other philosophy promises new bodies, hearts, and minds. Only in the gospel of Christ do hurting people find such incredible hope. Isn't that great? That's the promise we have. Our bodies will be perfect. They'll be physical. They'll be perfect. Thirdly, our bodies will be personal. What I mean by that is, when you are raised from the dead, you don't become somebody else. You are still you. It is you who will be raised from the dead, not somebody else. You know, in 1 John 3:2, John said, we shall be like him. We will be like Jesus. That doesn't mean we all become little mini-me's of Jesus without any distinction. It means we will inherit the heavenly DNA like Jesus, but we still retain our own identities. Think of it this way. You know, most all of us use a computer, and that computer is run on a certain program, a software package, a program. Occasionally we get notices to upgrade that program. We don't throw away the whole program. We upgrade the program to a better state. And in the same way, when we are raised from the dead, it is a renovation, it is a recreation, but we still are us at the core. How do I know that? Well, Luke 24:39, when Jesus appeared to his disciples, listen to what he said in his new resurrection body. See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. It is I. It's not somebody else. It is I. And your resurrection body, you will be you. You will not be someone else. You know, one of the most personal things that makes us individuals and different from anyone else is our name. Your name makes you who you are. It identifies you as a unique human being. Did you know we're going to keep our names in heaven? We're going to retain our names in heaven. In Matthew 8:11, Jesus said, I say to you that many will come from the east and west and will recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. Now, when Jesus had spoken this, Abraham had been dead for 2,000 years. But he's pointing to a future time, thousands of years in the future, when everyone will recline at the table. And guess what? After thousands of years, Abraham will be Abraham, Isaac will be Isaac, Jacob will be Jacob, and you will be you. Now, some people say, well, no, wait a minute, Pastor. I remember someplace in the Bible that says God will give us a new name in heaven. What about that? Well, it's true. In Revelation 2:17, God is going to give a group of extra special saints who are especially faithful a new name. It says, to him who overcomes, to him I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone and a new name written on the stone, which no one knows but he who receives it. But that new name is an additional name. It's not a replacement name. It's an additional name. For example, think of Jacob in the Old Testament. His name meant supplanter, heel catcher. But God also gave him an additional name, Israel, which means one who strives with God. Or think about Simon. Simon had a name that meant God is heard. But Jesus said, I'm going to give you an additional name, Peter, which means rock. In the same way, for those of us who serve especially faithfully, God is going to give an additional name. What does all of this mean when we put it together? It means in heaven, we won't be someone else. You will be you. And the relationships, by the way, you have here on earth with Christians will continue in heaven. You'll know other people, they will know you, and you will enjoy perfect fellowship, untainted by sin of any kind. Ron Rhodes, theologian, says it this way, our eternal reunion with Christian loved ones and friends will be ceaselessly glorious. Keep in mind that we will no longer have sin natures. There will be no fights among loved ones. There won't be any resentment or envy or jealousy. There won't be any one-upmanship or rivalries. There won't be any cross words or misunderstandings or selfishness. Our relationships in heaven will be truly wonderful and utterly satisfying. Now that's something to look forward to in that place called heaven. I want to share with you so much more that I've learned about this amazing place called heaven. And that's what we're going to do in the days ahead. And we've made arrangements to provide a number of helpful resources to expand your understanding of that place called heaven as well, if you'll contact us today. The first, of course, is a copy of my best-selling book that's just been released. It's called A Place Called Heaven, 10 Surprising Truths About Your Eternal Home. And when you give a generous gift to support the ministry of Pathway to Victory, I'll make sure the hardbound edition is sent to your home. It comes with my profound thanks for your partnership with this ministry. As an added resource, I've prepared a fold-out brochure that illustrates what seven world religions teach about heaven. This at-a-glance guide is something you can tuck into your copy of my book, A Place Called Heaven. And I highly recommend giving a copy to your son, daughter, or grandchild to give them a better understanding of what their friends may believe about heaven and how it contradicts the true teaching of God's Word. Now, when your generous gift is $75 or more, in addition to the hardbound book, A Place Called Heaven, and the brochure, What Seven World Religions Teach About Heaven, I'll send you the complete series, A Place Called Heaven, unedited on both audio CDs and DVDs. These recordings contain far more teaching material than we've had time to include on our broadcasts. This gives you the luxury of listening at your own pace or sitting down with your family or Bible study group to watch these presentations as well.